My name is Lenora Henson, for those of you who don't know me, and I'm the curator, director of public programming here at Theodore Roosevelt inaugural site. On behalf of our board of trustees and our staff, I'd like to welcome everyone to our first speaker night of 2017. On the fourth Tuesday of most months, we invite speakers to come in and help us think about topics relating to Theodore Roosevelt, his 1901 inauguration right here in Buffalo, and or issues that were important during his lifetime. We're grateful to M&T Bank, as well as the New York State Council on the Arts, for helping to make speaker night possible. This evening, I'm delighted to welcome Dr. Tom Reigstad, who will be exploring the, would you say uneasy is a?
Understatement.
The uneasy relationship between Theodore Roosevelt and Mark Twain, of course, two very big personalities of the era. Tom is a fourth-generation Buffalonian, an English professor, and a journalist. He first learned of Twain's late 1860s affiliation with Buffalo while attending graduate school at the University of Missouri. After working as a journalist in the Army, Tom returned to Buffalo to continue work as a journalist and to teach writing and literature. He has published widely on Twain's Buffalo phase and has presented at international Twain conferences. An award-winning emeritus professor of English at SUNY College at Buffalo, Tom spent 26 years working within steps of a fireplace mantelpiece that was once part of Twain's home in Buffalo. Tom was a feature writer and a copy editor at the Buffalo Courier Express, whose forerunner, the Buffalo Morning Express, was the newspaper co-owned and co-edited by Twain from 1869 to 1871. So we have a Twain expert who's gonna help us explore that uneasy relationship with Theodore Roosevelt, and I'm delighted to turn the podium over to Dr. Tom Reigstad. Please join me in welcoming him.
Well, thank you, Lenora, for the lovely introduction, and I'm very pleased to be here this evening to talk about the intersections between two of America's most famous men of the late 19th and early 20th centuries, Teddy Roosevelt and Mark Twain. As we shall see, they covered some of the same physical terrain here in Buffalo. They were both authors and orators. They were beloved by the American public. They had gigantic egos. Their domestic lives were filled with a tight family circle spent in gorgeous mansions, and were plagued by tragedy. They were both conflicted about wealth, the average common laborer, and entrepreneurship, and they had a deep respect for each other on a personal level. However, they had distinctly different lifestyles and were worlds apart on economic and political policies. These key differences were mostly expressed in private, but sometimes spilled over into the public arena. Their relationship, as Lenora hinted at, was quite complicated. For example, right here on the TR inaugural site website advertisement for tonight's event cites this enticing quote by Mark Twain on Teddy Roosevelt, in which Twain called TR far and away the worst president we have ever had. Now, Twain dictated this statement for his autobiography in 1906, an autobiography which he declared in his will not be released for 100 years. Interestingly, the quote in full reads, "Roosevelt is far and away the worst president we have ever had, and also the most admired and the most satisfactory." Kind of reminds me of Ernest Hemingway's famous 1935 quote, "All modern American literature comes from one book by Mark Twain called Huckleberry Finn. All American writing comes from that. There was nothing before, there has been nothing as good since." That's the part always quoted. Hemingway went on to say, "If you read Huckleberry Finn, you must stop where the nigger Jim is stole from the boys. That is the real end. The rest is cheating." So it's always well worth digging below the surface, and I hope we do a little of that this evening. I could almost stop my talk here with these two slides. The birthplace images of Twain first, and then T.R. Because they tell the whole story, pretty much, of both men. Samuel Langhorne Clemens was born November 30th, 1835, in a very tiny town in Missouri, Florida, Missouri. There were barely 100 people there. And this is a photo of the home into which he was born in Florida, Missouri. A rough two-room cabin. There were barely 100 people in the village, and his family was quite poor. At the age of four, they moved to Hannibal, Missouri, which most of us affiliate more commonly with Twain's childhood, which is a slightly larger, maybe 1,000 people, thriving town on the banks of the Mississippi River. Regardless of whether you look at Florida, Missouri, or his developmental period growing up in Hannibal, those towns were west of the Mississippi River. And in Twain's time, at the time of his birth, 1835, that part of the country was backwater country. It was pioneer land, frontier land, rough, undeveloped, almost uncivilized, and certainly uncultured, reflecting the sentiments of the Deep South regarding slavery. In fact, the Presbyterian preacher at the church that Twain attended as a child extolled the virtues of slavery. His own family, as poor as they were, had a couple of slaves at times, and an uncle of Twain's owned a plantation upriver with lots of slaves. Teddy Roosevelt, on the other hand, was born in a fashionable district in New York City, among an enclave of well-connected and extended Roosevelt family members on East 20th Street in October of 1858. So please keep in mind that Teddy Roosevelt was 23 years younger than Mark Twain. T.R.'s father was a lawyer, his uncle was a publisher, and the life trajectories of these famous men, I think, are quite fascinating. Teddy Roosevelt, born to wealth, strived his entire life to identify with the other half. In fact, one of his mentors was a journalist in New York City at the New York Tribune, Jacob Riis, who wrote in 1890, after doing so much reporting about the tenement districts in New York and immigrant families, poor immigrant families, a book called How the Other Half Lives. And it was very influential in the shaping of Teddy Roosevelt's sensitization to people who were much poorer than he was as a privileged American by birth. So he strove, T.R. did, to identify with the other half, the working class, and became disenchanted with the 19th century moguls and industrialists that surrounded him and his family as he was growing up, who he discovered ripped off cheap labor. On the other hand, again, Twain, born to poverty, while also identifying with his fellow working class Americans, had a lifelong desire to become a tycoon, to enter the elite, genteel, wealthy upper crust of American society. And to that end, Twain, born again in the rustic Western frontier, mercilessly satirized capitalists of the Gilded Age, such as Jay Gould. He was a particular target of Twain throughout his career. Yet, paradoxically, aspired to be one. He befriended Andrew Carnegie, who was about almost exactly the same age as Twain, born the same year. And he defended John D. Rockefeller, and again, desperately wanted to be accepted in the cultured, aristocratic Northeast. T.R., born to comfort in the Northeast, wanted to prove his affinity and manhood in the American West. So it was like cross purposes in their careers. To be sure, both men were influenced by the catchphrases of their day. Go West, young man, popularized, I don't think it was originated by, but popularized by Horace Greeley of the New York Tribune. And then a few years later, Manifest Destiny, John Gast's famous 1872 illustration that we see here an illustration that accompanied travel brochures, kind of recruiting Easterners and their families to head westward, epitomized that prevailing westward ho adventurous spirit. It's really a remarkable drawing. You know, you see on the right-hand side the East Coast with commerce and everything, and then right in the middle of the drawing is, I don't know who that would be exactly, Lady Liberty, Columbia, whomever, Brunhilde, just kind of above the ground even, you know, dragging these telegraph lines and reaping destruction, you know, of the pristine West, throughout the West. But it's progress, it's modernization. I don't even know what book she's holding, but it's gotta be something righteous. At the bottom, there are the homesteaders, you know, ripping up the grass land with their plows and oxen. The land is already turned over in the drawing at the bottom. Also in the middle, stagecoaches and railroads, industrializing or, again, modernizing the American West. And that was the spirit, go West, make your fortune. It was the American dream that Twain and Roosevelt were so compelled by, as were their brothers and sisters in America in the mid and late 19th century. Of course, you have the wildlife, bears looking back kind of frightened where they're gonna live, where their natural habitats, the bison on the run. The indigenous people, I should say, the Native Americans, fleeing for their lives. As their homes were uprooted. But the negatives weren't dwelled on for anybody really, looking at this drawing for inspiration. Before heading east, Twain's career took him actually further west in the 1860s. And that move, too, highlights one of the most distinct differences between the two men. Because Twain avoided the signature event of his lifetime, the Civil War. He was a 26-year-old Mississippi riverboat pilot when the war broke out in 1861. But except for maybe a 10-day foray with the Missouri Confederate militia, he didn't see any action, but just riding around on horses and with the risk of some sort of encounters with the enemy, did not appeal to Twain. So he bailed on the war very quickly and spent the next 6 years in the Nevada Territory with his older brother and in California as a miner and newspaper reporter. Teddy Roosevelt sought solace from grief out west after in New York City his first wife, Alice, died and he witnessed that death, and on the very same day, and I think in the same house, his mother died as well. So he went out west in 1884 to work as a rancher, to become a cowboy. But by contrast, it seems as though Teddy Roosevelt never saw a war he didn't like. While Assistant Secretary of the Navy, of course, he left that post to form the Rough Riders during the Spanish-American War in 1898. And years later, begged President Woodrow Wilson to let him enlist in his late 50s in World War I. And inspired his sons to fulfill their manly, patriotic duty to become soldiers in World War I, a legacy that turned out badly. All four sons of Roosevelt saw combat on the front lines in World War I. His son Quentin died when his plane was shot down behind enemy lines in Germany. Teddy Jr. was shot in the kneecap, and another son was wounded. Decades later, all three surviving sons participated in the military in World War II, and again, Teddy Jr. died shortly after the D-Day invasion. Twain's association with presidents had a pretty good record already before he encountered Teddy Roosevelt. And that association with presidents starts right here in Buffalo. And I'd like to take a very quick tour of Twain's time in Buffalo and his association with presidents here. Forgot to show you a couple of images of Roosevelt out west as a cowboy. in the mid-1880s. Why did Twain come to Buffalo? Well, this lovely woman, Olivia Langan, whom he met when he, after returning from a trip abroad in 1867, he had met her younger brother on that trip. And he spent from late 1867 for another year and a half after that courting Olivia Langdon, whose family came from Elmira, New York, and her father was a multimillionaire coal dealer. I suspect that that was one of the reasons that Twain was interested in her. Olivia rebuffed marriage proposals at least three times during that period, but finally agreed to become engaged in February of 1869. This is what Twain looked like when he lived in Buffalo from 1869 to 1871 in his early 30s. He came here first as an engaged man, but still a bachelor for a few months. The other reason that he came actually to Buffalo was Olivia Langdon's father, Jervis, that coal dealer and multimillionaire in Elmira. They mined the coal for the J.J. Langdon Coal Company in the Anthracite Coal District, Scranton area of Pennsylvania, shipped it north through the headquarters office in Elmira to the Erie Canal, and barges took it east or west to customers. But the Buffalo office of the Langdon Coal Company was key, of course, because trains could ship the coal westward, and there was the Great Lakes to, you know, put coal on ships as well to customers. So, and with Buffalo being so close, just a four-hour train ride between Buffalo and Elmira, Langdon knew that he could see his daughter pretty often. And as fate would have it, there was an opening for an ownership, one-third ownership in the Buffalo Morning Express, a very solid newspaper. And Jervis Langdon convinced his future son-in-law to buy that one-third interest, actually gave him money to do that, and become managing editor and co-owner of the Buffalo Express. I'm going to talk just a little bit longer about coal, because it comes up later on in the talk tonight in connection with Twain and Roosevelt. This was the coal yard of the J.J. Langdon Company in Buffalo. They had an office at 221 Main Street, but the coal yard was right here. And this is the Erie Canal running to the east of it, and to the west was Lake Erie. And there were slips where barges could, you know, come in and out. But on the Langdon property, you can see there's a spur of the New York Central Railroad. So coal could be dumped, you know, from barges, from trains, and picked up by ships. And right now, the land has changed quite a bit, but the coal yard of the Langdon Coal Company would be about where Templeton's Landing Restaurant is, or where the monument for the Irish famine is located, that area. And ironically, for the last 6 years of Twain's life, he co-owned that property. His wife predeceased him, even though she was 10 years younger than him. And he shared that parcel, paid taxes on it, and collected rent on it, because the Langdon Coal Company had long since abandoned it, but they owned the property. Okay, let's move on with Twain and Buffalo. This is an aerial photo of Buffalo taken from the St. Paul's steeple, scaffolding. They were repairing the steeple. This is Main Street heading south toward the waterfront. This is Washington Street heading south toward Key Bank Arena. And this is Swan Street, East Swan Street, heading eastward. Okay. This dark building here that used to be had been a mansion at one time was a boarding house that had about 20 boarders in different one room and two room apartments at 39 East Swan. And it's where Twain lived as a bachelor from August through December of 1869. The front of this building here, which we'll see shortly, was where the Buffalo Express offices were. So he could fall out of bed and he'd be at work. But you can see how densely populated in 1870 Buffalo already was. Small businesses was just thriving. The population was 110,000, it was booming. and that's the city that Twain, you know, first entered as a full-time worker, journalist, a good job, owner of a paper, and he was soon to become, you know, quite wealthy by the largesse of his in-laws. This is a photograph of 14 East Swan Street, right here, the Buffalo Express building, the south side of the Ellicott Square building. Ellicott Square building would be the where the offices were. The presses were in the basement, and on the third floor were editorial, fourth floor was the composing room. But on this third floor middle window here is where Twain's little alcove was when he worked at the Express. Two pieces that he wrote early, he not only was managing editor and co-owner, but he also wrote a lot for the Express. Two early pieces in the fall of 1869 are worth noting. One was given the headline, The Monopoly Speaks. And there was a consortium of coal companies in Buffalo, four of them, that formed a monopoly and sold anthracite coal, which was the kind of coal used by most people, you know, dwellings and businesses and that sort of thing, even I think trains, hired coal. And they figured they could jack up the prices over the summer of 1869 by forming a monopoly, cornering the market. And residents were up in arms about this. There were rallies and forums in the late summer, early fall of 1869, you know, crying out against the monopoly of coal companies. And one of those four companies was the J.J. Langdon Coal Company, involved in this enterprise of, you know, squeezing as much money as possible, raising the number of dollars per ton that they were charging the public. And the Buffalo Express was very sympathetic to the anti-monopoly cause and published all kinds of articles and descriptions of the forums. When Twain, I should say, came on board, he published this editorial defending the monopolies. It was unsigned, but it was clear to everyone in town who wrote it, especially the journalists of rival newspapers who made a couple of snide remarks in their newspapers about this sudden reversal in editorial policy by the Buffalo Express. But it kind of shows how Twain was capable of using his own bully pulpit, the newspaper, for, you know, his private interests, defending his father-in-law's corporate, you know, enterprise. Even though he had been a miner, Twain, you know, himself, and you would think he'd be sympathetic to laborers and to everyday people and keeping prices down, but not in this case. Another piece that he wrote early at the Express had the headline, and again, I apologize for the N-word, but only a nigger. And people in the fall of 1869 in Buffalo, you know, reading this over a cup of coffee, may have choked the first time, you know, they saw the headline and read the first paragraph. But when they read it carefully in the text, every time nigger is used, it's in quotation marks. And Twain sarcastically writes this piece, this editorial, and is stridently against lynching and against racism in the messy Reconstruction, which was only 4 years or 5 years, in progress. So a lot of scholars point to this, kind of obscure editorial in the Buffalo Express as a breakthrough in Twain's transformation from a deep Southern, type with growing up with slavery all around him, to someone maturing with a sense of social consciousness and social justice. And a lot of that influence was due in his change of heart and soul was due to the Langdon family, his time spent with them, with Olivia. The Langdons were staunch abolitionists before and during the Civil War. They even used their home, their mansion in Elmira, as a way station on the Underground Railroad. So he was learning, he was developing. This editorial sort of presages the message in Adventures of Huckleberry Finn, the very you know, anti-racist theme in that novel 15, 16 years later. When Twain and Olivia got married in Elmira in early February 1870, after he had been a bachelor a few months in Buffalo working at the Express, his in-laws gave Olivia and Twain this amazing wedding present, a mansion at 472 Delaware Street, as it was known back then. It was the second house from the corner of Virginia, going north, the south side, on the west side, I should say. And if you ever ate at the Cloister restaurant in the years that that was open, it was at the same site as this house, which was torn down in 1963. Twain and Olivia lived there for 13 months, but this was Twain's dream, you know, to have come this far, to have a responsible job and, you know, a gift by his millionaire parents-in-law that included three servants and all other, lots of other amenities. They'd get checks for hundreds of dollars periodically from the in-laws in Elmira. This is a page from the 1870 Buffalo City Directory, and you see Twain did not use his pseudonym, his public brand name, Mark Twain, for the city directory. He used his private, you know, real name, Clemens S.L., his profession, editor of Buffalo Express, and his home address, 472 Delaware. There are no phones back then, of course, so this is how the city directories ran. What's interesting is, about seven or eight entries down is Grover Cleveland, a young attorney who was about Twain's age. He was in his early 30s as well, with the Lanning and Folsom law firm. And it's true, especially in the months, the late months of 1869, when Twain was single, living in Buffalo, that he and Cleveland ran into each other, and I'm sure bellied up to the bar a couple of times together, especially in German beer gardens that were so frequent around Buffalo at that time. And years later, while Twain lived in Buffalo and worked in Buffalo, Cleveland launched his political career by running successfully for Erie County Sheriff in 1870. Of course, he went on to become mayor of Buffalo, governor of New York, and two-time president. I think he was 22nd, 24th, non-successive terms. And when he was governor, Twain visited him in the governor's mansion in Albany, and they reminisced about their time together in Buffalo. And when he was president, one of those terms, Twain also visited him at the White House, and they talked about their days together in Buffalo. And this is a photograph of Cleveland about at the time that Twain would have known him in Buffalo. Just a little bit of more information about the status that Twain had arrived at. Again, this is one of many fireplace mantelpieces, one that survives from the Twain home. You can see it in the Mark Twain room at the Central Library downtown. Beautiful carved cherry. They had their own calling cards, the Clemenses did, and they made social expeditions to, you know, many of the families of the Buffalo's upper crust, usually Presbyterians, throughout Buffalo when they lived here. And when during the time that Twain lived here, he only gave one public lecture. And that was in March of 1870, about 5 weeks into his residency at that wedding gift mansion. And it was given in the auditorium of the Young Men's Association building, which was on Main Street. And I think, is that Huron? Is that where M&T Plaza is? Is that Huron? Okay. Or maybe Mohawk, but that's where the Young Men's Association building was. Twain was a member of the Young Men's Association, and the building sponsored lecture series, and would bring in, you know, many famous people, Henry Ward Beecher, and so, you know, Twain was invited. And he agreed, that particular lecture in March of 1870 was sponsored by the Grand Old Army of the Republic, and he agreed to give the proceeds to that charity organization. And the organizers of that lecture had decided to have Millard Fillmore, who was the grand old man of Buffalo, the 13th president, long out of office, but you know, settling in Buffalo as an elder statesman. His home, his mansion, was where City Hall is today. He was the most famous man in Buffalo. But the organizers of Twain's lecture had set it up so that Millard Fillmore, this esteemed figure, would introduce Twain on stage. Now, they didn't know that Twain can be quite prickly, and he had already had quite a lecture career before he came to Buffalo, and he would have one long after that, too. But he never wanted anyone to introduce him. He would amble onto the stage very slowly, look around, not say anything, and then eventually people would start giggling, and then he'd start his drawl and his, you know. So he didn't need a warm-up or anybody to introduce him. So when Fillmore, backstage, you know, tried to walk on stage with him, Mark Twain shrugged him off. And the organizers from the Grand Old Army of the Republic were horrified. Twain proceeded, though. So that was his one face-to-face encounter with Millard Fillmore in Buffalo. You know, it did not go well for, well, Fillmore, for one. Then just one more mention of Buffalo. There was a lot of tragedy that befell Twain in Buffalo. So tragedy was no stranger to both Twain and Roosevelt. And it began for Twain before he came to Buffalo, really. You know, his favorite brother was blown up in a steamboat accident. Then once in Buffalo, his beloved father-in-law died of stomach cancer in Elmira while they were living in Buffalo. A girlfriend of his wife's came to Buffalo to help Olivia get over the grief, and she died in their master bedroom of typhoid fever. Their firstborn child was delivered a month prematurely in Buffalo in the mansion on Delaware Avenue. His name was Langdon, and he was so sick at birth that they feared he would die every day. He did die at only the age of 1.5 years after they'd moved on to Hartford, Connecticut, died of diphtheria. This is Langdon. One more president that Twain associated with before encountering Roosevelt was U.S. Grant, the 18th president. Long after Grant left the White House, his one term, I think, as president, his personal fortune started going downhill. He was never really a rich man anyway, but Mark Twain heard about his financial condition, and by that time, the early 1880s, Twain had founded his own publishing company, Charles Webster Company, he called it. And he visited Grant at his family farm and home and asked if he would be willing to write his memoirs. Twain would be happy to publish them in his publishing company. And he would also give Grant 75% of the royalties, which was unheard of. So Grant, who not only was, his finances were wrecked, so was his health, he was dying. But he got busy in 1885, I think it was, and finished his memoirs. Twain published them, and I think before they came out, in two volumes, Grant had already expired. But they became a bestseller. The writing was pretty snappy. The public gobbled it up. And the book made $400,000 in 1880s money for the Grant survivors. And his family was quite, you know, well off then, partly because of Twain's publication of the book. So that brings us to the William McKinley administration with Teddy Roosevelt as vice president. This is Teddy Roosevelt on the stump in 1900. McKinley had been was reelected in 1900 with Roosevelt as his vice president. Remember the 23-year age difference between the two men. This is a photograph of Mark Twain in 1900. And this is a poster from the 1900 election campaign, with McKinley as president and TR as its running mate. And as we all know, in September of 1901 at the Pan American Exposition in Buffalo, McKinley was shot. Twain was vacationing with his family in the Adirondacks at the time and immediately wrote a letter referring to the anarchist assassin, Leon Czolgosz, as this ass with the unpronounceable name, who was probably more insane than usual. In the letter, Twain went on to express his hope that Buffalonians wouldn't rush the jailhouse and as a mob and lynch the assassin. Teddy Roosevelt, ironically enough, was also in the Adirondack region at the time of the shooting and rushed to Buffalo once McKinley's death was imminent. And on September 14th, was sworn in this building at 641 Delaware Avenue, as Lenore mentioned, the Wilcox Mansion. Ainsley Wilcox was an attorney. And this is a photograph of Roosevelt outside the Milburn House, a little bit north of here on Delaware Avenue, where McKinley's was trying to be treated by doctors, where he died of the bullet wound and infection. This is for the fuzzy photograph of the Wilcox Mansion after McKinley's death with the black mourning bunting. I just want to emphasize the Wilcox Mansion here on Delaware because when Twain lived on Delaware Avenue, just a couple blocks south of here at 472 Delaware in 1870 to 1871, another attorney occupied the premises. There's a long history of attorneys living in this house. But when Twain lived in Buffalo, the attorney living here was Albert Pierce Lanning. And during Twain's Buffalo residency, Lanning was in his early 50s and with the law firm Lanning, Folsom and Willett, which I had shown on the city directory. Folsom, of course, eventually became Grover Cleveland's mentor and father-in-law. And another example, if you need any, of Buffalo's famed 3 degrees of separation phenomenon. In 1874, a young graduate of Cornell University, James Fraser Gluck, began studying law in the office of Lanning and Willett, and soon entered as a partner in the law firm Lanning, McMillan, and Gluck. In 1885, Gluck wrote to Mark Twain in Hartford, Connecticut, asking Twain to donate the handwritten manuscript of Adventures of Huckleberry Finn to the Buffalo Library. And Twain did exactly that. That's a story for another evening. Twain was a dedicated walker. He undoubtedly passed by the Lanning Wilcox Mansion many times while exploring his Delaware district neighborhood. Twain was very familiar with the old North Street Cemetery across the street and wrote satirically about its dilapidated condition in a story in the Buffalo Express. He is also known to have attended Westminster Presbyterian, kitty corner from the Wilcox Mansion. So although 3 decades apart, T.R. and Twain frequented the same Delaware turf in Buffalo. And having mentioned Twain's love of long walks, I'm going to take another quick detour to explore a significant contrast in lifestyle between T.R. and Twain. Teddy Roosevelt was hyperactive, overachieving, an athlete, an outdoorsman, a macho hunter, an extremely active, physically active adult. He was a rower in college. He taught his kids to play football and often challenged White House guests to wrestling and boxing matches. Twain, on the other hand, opted for more sedentary recreational pursuits. He was very fond of billiards and of playing golf, which he described once as a good walk spoiled. Here's Twain attempting to play golf in Bermuda in the last months of his life in 1910. He was playing actually with another future president, Woodrow Wilson, who at that time was the president of Princeton University, and he was vacationing in Bermuda. They were playing golf together. You see the black armband around that Twain was wearing. That was in honor of his middle daughter, Jean, who had died on Christmas Eve of 1909. All of Twain's children except one predeceased him, and as I mentioned, his wife did as well. But in addition, besides walking and golf, truth be told, Twain was happiest just lying in bed, writing, or especially reading the newspaper. Both men were active authors and were very prolific. T.R. wrote a lot of books about military history and its travels around the world, his hunting trips, and about the American West. Twain wrote, as you know, tons of nonfiction and fiction classics. Twain wrote for 20 summers in a special eight-sided study in Elmira, built for him by his sister-in-law. And when they moved to Hartford, Connecticut, he designed a unique third-floor study for himself, where he spent a productive and happy 17 years. That den had a writing desk and also a pool table. One of T.R.'s favorite writing spaces was his study at Sagamore Hill Mansion, his oasis, his refuge for he and his family on Long Island. This was T.R.'s writing desk at Sagamore Hill. This is Twain's home that he built and paid for with mostly his wife's family money in Hartford, Connecticut. Both Sagamore Hill and the Hartford Mansion of Twain's are museums now for the public, and I recommend them. And here is the writing den on the third floor of Twain's Hartford home. Moving on, both men were family men, strong family men. They had close-knit families. T.R.'s was more on the masculine side. He had four boys and two girls. And this is a family portrait. One of the children is missing of the Roosevelt clan. Twain's family, after their firstborn son died at the age of a year and a half, they went on to have three daughters. So Twain was in a household of women for the most part in Hartford. But they were all pretty close, the Roosevelts and the Clemenses. Both men had one headstrong daughter. For Teddy Roosevelt, it was Alice, the daughter of his first wife, who the Washington, D.C. press called Princess Alice. They also called her the other Washington Monument. She was a socialite, and her activities, you know, grabbed headlines by journalists and the public. She was a partier. Roosevelt and his wife complained about all the time she spent on the telephone in the White House. And she wound up marrying a very wealthy Washington social guy, Nick Longworth, who was 16 years older than her, which was a mild scandal. And this is another photograph of Alice, and I think you can kind of see her attitude coming out of the photo. I don't want to say anything. But and for Clemens, for Twain, it was his daughter Clara, who had kind of a love-hate relationship with her father, and her father had a love-hate relationship with her, too. She was loyal, but had her own life to lead, and that was to become an opera singer, and later, when that didn't work out very well, a concert pianist. And that never quite took off either. This is her with her husband, who was a classical concert pianist, and her teacher. They had a very fractious relationship, and she was always complaining to Twain that he wasn't publicizing her concerts enough, and that sort of thing. And he didn't like some of the private secretaries that Twain had late in his life. So they had kind of a fractious relationship. Again, highlighting some differences between the two men, Roosevelt glorified warfare. His exploits in Cuba led the Spanish to sue for peace after the Battle of San Juan Hill, though the actual story may not be quite as glorious. But both Teddy Roosevelt and Twain saw United States claims on Cuba and the Philippines as mutually beneficial. and a natural extension of manifest destiny. So Twain's sense of manifest destiny didn't necessarily end with California. Now, he saw some benefits in the United States spreading its tentacles, a little further around the world, but Twain's views on imperialism changed drastically after the Boxer Rebellion in China, and he soon declared himself an ardent anti-imperialist as he learned more about the behavior of American soldiers in the Philippines. Now, Twain referred to colonization and the U.S. spreading across the globe as imperialism. Roosevelt called it expansionism. But Twain was named vice president of the anti-imperialist league. And without naming Twain specifically, Roosevelt called the anti-imperialists traitors. From that point on, from about 1901 until Twain's death in 1910, the rancor between these two larger-than-life American figures kind of escalated, basically the last decade of Twain's life. Twain was the one who delivered the most frequent cutting remarks, although most of them were hidden from the public through letters and mostly his private autobiographical dictations. But the sparring began between the two men shortly after McKinley's assassination. In the fall, McKinley died in the middle of September 1901. TR was sworn in here. And in the fall of 1901, this is Teddy as a Rough Rider again. There are lots of editorial cartoons promoting Roosevelt's, at the time, promoting Roosevelt's imperialistic tendencies and policies. And with Twain's anti-imperialist stance, he risked being chastised and cut off from the dominating Republican Party that was Roosevelt's party. And an editorial cartoon of the time criticized Mark Twain's anti-imperialism and his separation from the Republican Party, calling what Twain was doing as the biggest joke ever. This is Booker T. Washington, who was born to slavery, of course, became a teacher in Alabama, and in 1901 wrote his memoir, Up From Slavery, which became an instant bestseller. So Teddy Roosevelt was barely in the White House in the fall of 1901 after Washington's book had come out. And he was already known, widely as a teacher and influential African American. Roosevelt decided to invite Booker T. Washington to the White House. And he was the first African American ever to be invited to the White House. Not long after that, just a couple of weeks after Washington accepted the invitation and visited the White House, to some criticism by some journalists and public figures, there was an event at Yale University in October of 1901, celebrating Yale's bicentennial. Twain and Theodore Roosevelt were both there, receiving honorary doctorates. Although one newspaper account described Twain and Roosevelt joking together before the ceremonies, Twain had recently urged missionaries to abandon China and return to America because they'd be safe from American interference abroad. And they'd also be able to tend to fallen Christians here in the United States. So at that Yale event, while Twain was receiving an extended ovation on stage for his honorary doctorate, Teddy Roosevelt, who was off to the side a little bit, to the Secret Service, was still very nervous about public appearances and handshaking and all that, in the wake of McKinley's assassination, while Twain was, soaking up the applause, T.R., off to the side of it, was heard to mutter, "When I hear what Mark Twain and others have said, in criticism of the missionaries, I feel like skinning them alive. But later on at that Yale University function, Teddy Roosevelt took Twain aside and asked if he had been right to invite Booker T. Washington to dine at the White House. And Twain rather timidly suggested to T.R. that he may have risked offending a great many people with that invitation. Afterwards, though, in private, Twain reflected that Booker T. Washington was, quote, worth 100 Roosevelts, a man not fit to tie Washington's shoes. T.R.'s second thoughts about having invited Washington, I think, reflects his ambivalence at that time in his life about race. At one point, he's purported to have accused some of his black soldiers among the Rough Riders of cowards, of being cowards. I think that, you know, he was interested in one of the prevailing theories of the dominance of the white race at the time. But Twain's verbal sniping of T.R. was relentless. He called T.R. the missing link, you know, half ape and half Homo sapiens. He considered Vice President William Taft to be Teddy Roosevelt's serf, a spaniel who did whatever Roosevelt wanted him to do. And at one point, he described Taft as Roosevelt's miscarriage preserved in alcohol. I know, that's pretty nasty. Twain's tirades continued. Roosevelt is all bluster, all gas. He hasn't any real courage. Even Jelly McKinley was a man compared with this kitten that masquerades in a lion's skin. Now, it just goes to show you when Twain would go off on those, you know, rages and rants Roosevelt, I should say, that you know, they were so opinionated and wild that they weren't based on facts, or maybe they were alternative facts. But because, you know, McKinley was anything but jelly, you know, he entered the Civil War as a private, exited as a major, and saw lots of combat duty, including the bloodiest battle of the war at Antietam. So Twain was just really overreaching there. A personal gesture of kindness that Mark Twain never forgot occurred in 1904. Now, Olivia, again, 10 years younger than Twain, was rather fragile for most of her life. And in the early 1900s, Twain took his two daughters to Italy, and his wife to Italy, hoping that Olivia, the climate there and the pace of life would be more conducive to her health. But she died in Florence, Italy in 1904. And when that happened, he and his two daughters took a steamship eventually back to New York City in the summer of 1904. And when Roosevelt found out about that trip, he knew about the death, he instructed his cabinet to issue a special directive to allow Twain's family passage through customs in New York City without delay, to leave their abundant luggage from having lived in Italy for 10 months unopened and undisturbed. And Twain never forgot that act of kindness. And then, not long after that, in November of 1905, Twain dined with the Roosevelts at the White House. Now, he was a widower by that time, so it was just him dining with Edith Roosevelt and Teddy. All professional animosity was forgotten at that dinner, and the two men charmed each other. Twain was especially taken by Edith and wrote a very nice thank you note afterward. And Twain, at that White House dinner, allegedly took the opportunity to bend T.R.'s ear about how Belgium's King Leopold was brutally abusing native laborers to harvest rubber in the Congo. And after his White House lunch, Twain wrote, "You can't help liking Roosevelt, for he is a magnetic creature, and he shows his teeth in his forceful smile just as much as ever. And he unconsciously says that he is delighted to see you, just as the caricaturists have it on record." Certain headline-grabbing issues during the first decade of the 20th century further illustrate the political animosities between Twain and TR. The coal strike of 1902, the Philippine Massacre, and the Brownsville, Texas riots of 1906, the Jamestown, Virginia World's Fair, and the In God We Trust ruling of 1907, and then Roosevelt's trust-busting initiatives. In 1902, TR met with miners and coal operators to settle a five-month-old Pennsylvania anthracite coal strike. And this is the area of Pennsylvania that where Twain's coal baron father-in-law had his company's coal mines. TR was the first president to ever interfere in a labor dispute, and Roosevelt threatened to send soldiers in to run the mines. He was largely praised for his intervention. The settlement did bring some gains for workers, but not union recognition. However, TR's actions elicited no praise from Mark Twain, who, as a kind of libertarian, frowned on the executive department's meddling in private business. Twain didn't exactly come out in favor of the miners, even though, as I said, he had been a silver miner himself, nor did he favor the coal operators, contrary to his defense of the corporate coal companies, the monopoly when he lived in Buffalo. He was simply against TR's intervention. Then in March of 1906, 600 Muslim Filipinos, some of them women and children, who resisted the United States colonization were wiped out by US troops who were led by Theodore Roosevelt's army buddy, Leonard Wood, under his command. Twain immediately cried out at this act of imperialism as a universal act of error and criticized Roosevelt's praise of Wood's military leadership and how Roosevelt had promoted Wood to major general during a congressional recess. But Theodore Roosevelt this time fired back, incensed once again that this acclaimed public figure, beloved public figure, Mark Twain, was publicly again siding with anti-imperialists, and he privately called Twain a prize idiot. This is Leonard Wood, Major General Leonard Wood. The Brownsville, Texas incident exploded in August of 1906. A battalion of black infantrymen, I think it was the 25th, infantry unit, had been assigned to Brownsville on the Mexico border. And when a race riot erupted with the townspeople, the black soldiers fired on the white citizens of Brownsville. After the soldiers refused to testify against each other, Roosevelt stepped in and dishonorably discharged 167 black soldiers, an order that was reversed in 1972. Twain bitterly criticized Teddy Roosevelt's act as an effort to win back the Southern vote. And Twain further sneered, he convicted the entire command himself without evidence and without excuse. Things between the two gigantic public figures kept heating up. First, there was the In God We Trust fiasco of 1907, where Roosevelt had decided to eliminate the model for new $10 and $20 gold coins because of the, in his terms, sacrilegious connection between God and gold. Roosevelt found the motto to be irreverent. In an autobiographical dictation, Twain jumped on Teddy Roosevelt, sarcastically questioning Roosevelt's logic. He wrote, "That is just like the president. He is very much in the habit of furnishing a poor reason for his acts while there is an excellent one staring him in the face. The motto stated is a lie. If this nation has ever trusted in God, that time has gone by." And Congress did not waste any time. They overruled Roosevelt in 1908. Also in 1907, an international fair took place in Norfolk, Virginia, commemorating the 300th anniversary of the founding of the nearby Jamestown colonial settlement. Roosevelt and Twain were both present at that world's event. However, Twain, as you can imagine, upstaged the president. And when he arrived a day early, he told the press, "We expect to have a bully time." which was a dig at Roosevelt's favorite phrase. When Theodore Roosevelt finally got to the fair, he pulled into the Norfolk, Virginia shipyard, accompanied by several shiny, white-painted American battleships, which were about to set sail around the world in a show of America's military might. Twain commented on the fleet thusly, "The country has too many politicians who seem eager to unleash martial canines. Teddy Roosevelt has to be watched because he was tempted to do insanely spectacular things." Once again, Twain had rained on Roosevelt's public parade, and the New York Times seemed to agree. They wrote, "The crowd showed more interest in Mark Twain than they did the big naval review." Every school kid knows Teddy Roosevelt as the trust buster. One of his main targets, of course, was Standard Oil's John D. Rockefeller, one of the malefactors of great wealth, according to Roosevelt, and probably the richest American ever. This 1906 cartoon depicts Teddy Roosevelt as an infant Hercules trying to wrestle the two-headed serpent into submission. One head is Rockefeller, and the other is Henry Huddleston Rogers, H.H. Rogers, who was the chief executive officer of Standard Oil. He was also sometimes called Hellhound Rogers. But Rogers and Twain were very close friends. When Twain declared personal bankruptcy in 1895, Rogers took over Twain's personal finances and guided him back into solvency. And by the time Twain died in 1910, because of Rogers' guidance, he was quite well off and left a good inheritance to his only surviving daughter. So they were very close. Twain even arranged for an interview with H.H. Rogers by Ida Tarbell, the muckraking journalist who was preparing a huge, ripping expose of Standard Oil. When Tarbell met with Rogers, in the profile, he comes out quite positively, even though the rest was a scathing indictment of Standard Oil. But naturally, Twain stuck up for Rogers and described Theodore Roosevelt's attacks on trusts as atrocious, and mere indulgences in wordy bluster about what he was going to do, not what he was actually doing. Twain was the first of these famous Americans to die in 1910. But in his final years, he kept firing salvos and dripping venom from his private pen about Roosevelt. For example, Twain continued to ridicule T.R.'s masculinity, and took great glee in mocking Roosevelt's macho hunting trips that often bragged afterward about the total number of kills made. After one such expedition, when Teddy Roosevelt tallied the number of bears he shot, and I know this isn't a bear, Twain implied that Teddy Roosevelt had shot cows instead. And he wrote, "Some say it was a bear, a real bear. These were eyewitnesses, but they were all White House domestics. They were all under wages to the great hunter. And when a witness is in that condition, it makes his testimony doubtful." Then there was Twain's relentless but puzzling complaints about Teddy Roosevelt's showy public persona. Twain called T.R., quote, "the Tom Sawyer of American politics, still only 14 years old after living half a century. He takes a boy's delight in showing off, always hugging something or somebody." And this, "Teddy Roosevelt would go to Halifax for half a chance to show off, and he would go to hell for a whole one." And perhaps most ironic of all, Twain wrote, "Mr. Roosevelt is always hunting for a chance to show off. In his frenzied imagination, the great republic is a vast Barnum circus with him for a clown and the whole world for audience." Now these critiques really ring hollow, you know, by Twain, because he, of course, was a master showman, a master self-promoter himself, was his branding techniques throughout his career as a public figure. In fact, P.T. Barnum, whom he alluded to in that quote, was a friend of Twain's, whose advertising gimmicks Twain always admired. And in fact, here's a poster that Twain helped design for many of his lectures throughout his lifetime, with his likeness astride a frog jumping over a fence, you know, melding his image to a public in a day before mass media, and tying it in with one of his best known works. And posters like this would be plastered all over towns and cities and villages when he'd go on his lecture tours. So he knew what he was doing. He knew how to show off too. And it was said when Twain lived in New York City, he would take walks on Sunday mornings when churches were letting out, so that masses of people would be mingling with him in wonder that they were in his presence. When Twain died in 1910, Roosevelt graciously weighed in with this respectful statement. He was not only a great humorist, but a great philosopher. Although Twain may have smoked as many as 8 cigars a day for most of his adult life, he lived to his 75th year. And this is the last known photograph of Twain, coming back from Bermuda, actually, in the spring of 1910, from the harbor, being transported to his home in New York City. And he died in April of 1910. By contrast, the ever-robust Teddy Roosevelt died of a blood clot in January of 1919 at the relatively young age of 60. And one wonders if Twain had outlived TR, what public words of sympathy Twain might have expressed. So, two titans of America's booming past, legends in their own time, so much alike and enjoying each other's company in person, but allowing professional jealousy and political differences to put them at odds with each other in public. Thank you.